Well, here we are, Jimmy and I enjoying a beautiful moment looking at the southern ocean of the limestone coast. But this is part four of urinary incontinence, where we focus on management options for urinary incontinence in women. This is the last of the four series about this topic. Management options. Well, here you see a photo in one of the local pharmacies here in Adelaide, and you see an abundance of choices of incontinence material for women and men. Of course, this is an important coping strategy for patients with urinary incontinence. Of course, detailed information is outside the scope of the Daroga lecture, but we will try in our lecture to fix the problem. Good. What are management options for the most common urinary incontinence? That's urge and stress urinary incontinence. So this is the focus point of chapter four. There is conservative management options for urge and stress urinary incontinence, and that means pelvic floor exercises and bladder training. Medical is the preferred treatment option, of one of the treatment options for urge incontinence, and surgical is the main game for stress urinary incontinence, as we will see later on. Okay, let's go to conservative, so non-medical, non-surgical treatment options for urge urinary incontinence. The buzzword here is bladder training, bladder retraining. If we realize that the underlying mechanism is a very overactive bladder, reduced bladder volume to contain, to store urine, and frequency during the day and the night, the basic approach here is trying to defer listening to the bladder, trying to ignore the twitching of the bladder, which raises the alarm, come on, empty your bladder. So the detrusor contractions, which go through the brain, when we are aware of that, we try, in fact, the approach of systematic desensitization. That's also a part of the psychological component, because if you're worried about being incontinent already, that might have a worse effect. So there are a few deferral techniques. One of the techniques is squeeze the pelvic floor or put pressure on the perineum if you feel there is the urge arises. And sometimes we even can use biofeedback mechanisms. But the time deferral avoiding, I would like to stress, is a very useful approach. It takes time to explain this, but it means you basically could explain to the patient that the bladder has shrunk, has a much smaller volume than in ideal circumstances, and you want to train the bladder to accept more volume before it starts twitching and alerting the patient. So that means, for instance, the first week, you encourage her to defer going to the toilet by maybe 10 minutes and see how she goes. If that's achievable within 1 week, the second week, you can try to gain more time. So eventually, trying to ignore the bladder, who is raising attention and even anxiety sometimes for patients. So it's the systematic desensitization approach. This is takes time, and patients should realize they can relapse, that's fine. But eventually, this is one of the approaches which might be successful. It's important that it's a matter of as well regaining confidence. As I discussed with you before, the bladder has taken over the life of the woman, and she should actually try to tell the bladder off, as it were. Okay, eventually increasing her bladder volume and reduce frequency and a much better quality of life. This these bladder exercises I think ideally should be supervised by a dedicated physiotherapist. And it's not a matter of just, you know, you can Google it and download a leaflet and good luck, because that is not working. Here, the placebo effect is very important. And if there's a dedicated, committed doctor and physiotherapist, that will have a good positive effect on the outcome. Second part of conservative is lifestyle. Limit caffeine intake, alcohol beverages, reduce evening fluid intake, try to promote weight reduction, regular exercise. Those appear to be motherhood statements, but still will have an effect. A patient with chronic cough should be encouraged to discontinue smoking, because chronic cough exerts pressure on the pelvic floor and eventually might result in worse outcomes. The same important topic, especially for the elderly, there are a number of reversible causes of urinary incontinence. For instance, chronic constipation. So in that relation, in that regard, number two and number one have influence on each other. Here is a mnemonic which I like, because it helps us to look at reversible causes of urinary incontinence, especially in an older population, patients in nursing homes. It's diapers, D-I-A-P-P-E-R-S. And you can see here the list of the different reversible causes of urinary incontinence. It's good to check these before you go to more drastic measures. It's a good old mnemonic because it was first published in 1984. Okay, conservative for stress urinary incontinence. As we have discussed in the pelvic anatomy in the series of uterovaginal prolapse, the pelvic floor muscle forms a sling around the opening of the urethra, the vagina, and the rectum. And so by tensioning that muscle, the pelvic floor muscle, we can close off the hiatus of the urethra as well. So if a woman trains her pelvic floor very rigorously and consistently, she can rehabilitate and strengthen the pelvic floor muscles. And when she would start coughing or sneezing, she can deliberately, consciously tension the pelvic floor to close off and to prevent leakage of urine. Another way to do this is, there are different ways to do pelvic floor exercises, but the most effective one is small numbers of isometric repetitions at maximal exertion. So this is what a woman can be taught, can be instructed to do, and it is important that she does it regularly on a daily basis. It's not an exercise you should do for a few weeks. It should be part of your lifestyle. There are a few variations here, squeezing techniques, even cones, Kegel exercises. So it means a little cone or weight is inserted in the vagina, and the woman, when she squeezes the pelvic floor together, she prevents the weight from losing the weight or the cone. Also, variations are with or without biofeedback, but all these are variations on the same theme. The improvement of cure is quite good, 40 to 60% if supervised by a dedicated physiotherapist. So that is not bad if you realize that there is no known side effect, and that's different from medical or surgical treatments, as we will see later in this lecture. So pelvic floor muscle exercises, as we discussed already, is an important part of conservative treatment for stress urinary incontinence. Then medical. Medical is the treatment, one of the treatments if bladder training would not work, that we offer medical support. The basis is we offer an anticholinergic agent, which actually calms the parasympathetic nerve system going to the bladder. It means the bladder will not be inclined to the muscle, the detrusor will not be inclined to start contracting or twitching. A drug which is known, there are a few more, but this is the one we use commonly in Australia. It's oxybutynin or ditropan. We usually start with a dose of 2.5 milligrams Nocti, and it can be increased to 5 milligrams up to twice a day. Interesting, there are side effects, and at a higher dose, when the efficacy of the drug to improve the urinary incontinence is improved, the side effects kick in as well. The side effects are dry mouth, constipation, and blurred vision, so difficulties to read. So these side effects are, for many patients, in my experience, a reason to discontinue with the medication. An absolute contraindication is increased intraocular pressure, glaucoma. In randomized clinical trials, medication results in improvement of between 50 and 70%, but also we need to realize there is a significant placebo effect. And these studies quite often have not a very long duration, because if you would check the efficacy after the efficacy and the compliance after 1 year, you would see far worse outcomes. Okay, medical for urge continued. In women, postmenopausal women, where at examination the vagina is atrophic, you could try topical application of estrogens, a trial for instance for 6 weeks. We can offer Vagifem E2, estradiol, or Avastin is estriol E3. Important to try, and if it doesn't result in an improvement, to discontinue. Let's now move on to surgical options for stress urinary incontinence. Here is an abundance of reliable randomized clinical trials now with follow-up of even more than 5 years, so quite helpful to make up our minds. We have a number of minimal invasive sub-urethral or med-urethral slings, and we have the traditional operation which was performed with via laparotomy, the so-called Birch Culper suspension. The minimal invasive options, there are two variations: the tension-free vaginal tape, TVT, or the trans-obturator tape, abbreviation TOT or TVTO. The principle of these slings is that we introduce a mesh, a very small tape, below the urethra to support and elevate that mid part of the urethra. The traditional operation is done via a Fennesty laparotomy or open, so an open procedure, or also laparoscopically, minimally invasively. And here we look at the TVT, the tension-free vaginal tape operation. We can see here the pubic bone. This represents the urethra, and this represents how the sling is inserted through small incisions in this area and this area, and it's guided through the retropubic space, and here is where the tape comes out. So the proline tape runs through the retropubic space, as pointed out here, and the exit points are just in the abdomen suprapubically. Do realize that the tape is attached through not stitches, but the tape has some sort of Velcro type properties, so it has an intrinsic resistance, so that's how it attaches to the tissue. Here we see another diagram which explains beautifully how it works. Pubic bone, this is the urethra and the bladder, vagina and the uterus and the rectum. And here we can see that the tape is just underneath the mid trajectory of the urethra, going up through the retropubic space, and here are the exit points. By the way, the tape will be cut off and will retract slightly, so eventually it's not visible, the tape will not be visible through the skin. Here we see a very clever designed instruments which allow us to insert the tape as I described before. So special devices, special instruments, but it's a minimally invasive procedure and which can be done in maybe 15 to 20 minutes. The second operation, minimally invasive, is the TVT obturator, the TOT, And here we can see that the tape, by the way, this is my orientation, this is the pubic bone, this is the bladder, this is the urethra. The tape is just below the mid part of the urethra, but now it comes out through the obturator foramen. And the exit points are here in the groin area. So here are the exit points. Nice procedure, minimal invasive, and also with clever designed instruments. When we compare back-to-back the TOT versus the TVT, and we look at the cure rates, the subjective cure rates, so does the woman report that she is leaking less urine or no more urine? It's interesting, both at 1 year, they have comparable success rates, 1 to 5 year as well, no significant differences, and if after 5 years, and that's good news, both perform equally well. If you look at the primary reason why we inserted these tapes, that dealing with stress urinary incontinence. This is a systematic review, Cochrane database just recently published. By the way, despite the fact that we have quite a few studies, the quality of the studies is, according to the grade classification, low to moderate. And what is most important for the patient, the more than 5 year results, and in that regard, both are equally good. Now, let's look at complication rates. We have intraoperative complications, complications after the procedure, the hospital length of stay, and of course long-term complications. How do they compare back to back? Intraoperative bladder perforation, higher risk in the TVT because the retropubic space is very close to the bladder. Major vascular or visceral injury, very low, no differences. Postoperative complications, voiding difficulties, so the inability to void, urinary retention is lower in the transobturated tape approach. Groin pain, suprapubic pain, by the way, are of short-term duration, and of course each procedure, when you go through the obturator space, it's more likely to have groin pain, and when you enter the suprapubic pain, this retropubic area, more pain suprapubically. So makes sense. To me, not very relevant. Hospital length of stay, yes, for the TOT, shorter, and it has to do with a shorter mean operating time and also slightly lower blood loss. By the way, blood loss is in both instances very minimal, hardly ever it requires blood transfusion. And important for the patient, long-term complications, the tape erosion or exposure, that means the tape is exposed into the vagina, or that could result in pain or dyspareunia. Here we can see that it's 24 in 1,000 versus 21 in 1,000, and that's not significant. So, interesting back-to-back comparisons as far as the complication rate is concerned. TOT is preferred. So, based on the existing knowledge and good research, the transobturated tape is the first choice procedure for stress urinary incontinence if conservative measures such as pelvic floor exercises have not resulted in an improvement. And important to note that Daroga has no conflict of interest here whatsoever, so it's an independent, evidence-based opinion. I would like to pay some attention to the copper suspension of Birch. It can be done open, so via a fenestil laparotomy or via a laparoscopic approach. And the principles are explained well. Look at this diagram. The anterior abdominal wall has been removed. We see here the bladder, the urethra, and this is the pubic bone. This is the symphysis pubis. Stitches are put through the vagina, the anterior wall of the vagina on one hand, and then go through a ligament, which or actually is the periost of the pubic bone, is called the pecten pubis. So two or three stitches on each side, and it results in an elevation of the urethra, but now it's elevation because below this is the anterior vagina wall. So the anterior vagina wall is used to elevate the lower part of the bladder and the urethra. It's more invasive, open procedure. By the way, that open procedure, which was done traditionally, has very good efficacy, figures as high as 85 to 90% within the first year. And after 5 years, still 70% of the women can expect to be completely continent. So it's a procedure which has a good efficacy, but it's more invasive and has more complications. So in that review, in regard, not the first choice anymore. If we compare the cost effectiveness, that's of course important as well. If you look at the system, the macro level, TVT versus TOT, TOT is cheaper, about $2,368, so it's more cost effective as well, which confirmed our early conclusion based on clinical considerations. Yeah, TOT is the first choice procedure for stress urinary incontinence. What is the take home message of these four lectures about urinary incontinence? One, key to a successful assessment are, unsurprisingly, and number one, a thorough, detailed, focused, targeted history, which will take time. Physical examination, it's not highlighted because usually no abnormalities are seen or found, but still we will do an examination. The absence of prolapse is okay. Sometimes we find atrophy. Investigations, midstream microscopy and culture and sensitivity is important to exclude bladder infection or exclude hematuria. Only if need be in elderly women with suddenly onset of urine cytology is important. Ultrasound scan or other imaging modalities are highly recommended, and urodynamic testing in case of doubt. If the history is clear-cut, urodynamic testing has no proven benefit. Management options, conservative pelvic floor exercises for stress urinary incontinence, bladder training and or medical for urge urinary incontinence, and surgical minimal invasive sub or metrurethral sling operations, the TVT and the TOT, and as we discussed, they have the same cure rates, but TOT is the preferred choice because of lower complication rates and it's more cost effective. Last but not least important, what I notice in my practice in South Australia, that many women come to see us with the expectation that we can provide them with a quick fix, that modern medicine that's part of the culture. And women probably more or less like to outsource the problem to us. So we are the owner of the problem and the solution. I think it's important that we explain thoroughly that conservative options are reasonably effective without side effects. It's gives the advantage that a woman can self-manage, can regain her confidence in a very sensitive with very sensitive symptoms. This requires time, dedication, and perseverance, and that's contradictory to the quick fix approach, the drive-through approach. I would personally think that we should encourage women to try conservatively as well and support them in that, refer them to a dedicated physio, and also provide support ourselves. And if that is not working, I think the second option should be drugs and or procedures. Okay, Jimmy is looking after four lectures. Come on, it's time for a walk. And he is also bursting. He wants to sniff around. Okay, I thank you for your attention to these four lectures, and I trust it will help you in preparing for your exam, but also most importantly, that you will be a future competent and pleasantly confident and always caring clinician. Thank you.